percentage increase, economic development, you know, all these things, everybody knows, you know, you're kind of playing game with each other, right? So that is no way to negotiate, no way to win a war. You have to win a war in a place where you choose the battleground. You choose the battleground that the enemy don't know, but you know, and you prepare a base or trap, whatever it could be. So I have done that. And so now, with the two, I already chosen it, I started to talk to the negotiator. Small talk, try to remind him of his biggest fear, the union membership dropping. Very indirectly, you can see him very, very salty, you know. Then I also found one thing. We were about to have a union party, only for members. So I told him, what do you want? Of course I know what he wants. Right? What is the union membership to go up? I said, what do you want? Why do I do this? I help you to make the union party the best ever. Right? So that your members will be the envy of the non-members. Then you will see a reason to join the union. Because, to be honest with you, right? HP employees in those days have no reason to join the union. You know what HP stands for? Highly pampered. If you're all highly pampered, why do you need to join the union? And secondly, HP in those days never retrenched. Never retrenched. So why would anybody join the union? So I said, you need to find another way of these people to join the union. He was so happy. His eye was gleaming. If it gleamed anymore, he dropped off in the college board. But he was so happy, so what happened? Actually, what I did was I attacked where the enemy will not defend. This is what I assumed to talk about. Always attack an enemy who will not defend. You know, it's a very funny thing about Sun Tzu. He said the most obvious, and yet people don't do it. I attack in a place where he loves me to attack. Right? That's why, in the end, what he do? I actually shaped his action. He went to talk to the in-house chief about the deal. Right? The deal. Deal over. Finished. Closed. So what did I do? I actually won without fighting. Because the rest of the afternoon, to be honest with you, I was just playing games with them, right? Because I knew that was not where I need to fight the battle. The battle is not in the dollars and cents and percentage. He was trying to get the chief negotiator for MTC to see something even more important to him. And again, these are eight strategic considerations of Sun Tzu's article. And you can use that in incremental way, in different combinations, in order to come up with abnormal strategy. Now what happened next year? Negotiators are replaced. By his boss. And she's a female. No more toilet negotiation. Because I think they don't like the fact that she finished the negotiation in 7.5 hours. Whereas it's supposed to take 3 months. So I need a new approach. So I wanted to prolong all that. I literally told my staff, I'm going to check for 3 months. My staff say, you're very funny. Like, why sometimes you say you're not patient, then you'll check for 3 months. Result, we close the deal with a payout less than what I'm supposed to pay. You know, we always have a mandate how much we're allowed to pay. And actually, I paid less. But on the other hand, our relationship with the union actually improved tremendously. What happened? What was the approach? First of all, Sun Tzu says every strategy, even how great it is, cannot be defeated. Yang ma zhen yu yang, yang ma zhen yu yang. And I built my tower because the boss of the negotiator now is negotiating with me. I must give face to her. No matter what, I'm a jack for 3 months so that union members think that the boss of the negotiators is really great. Quite like how enough. To be honest with you, I go so fat that 3 months. I ask my chapter and try to break. Because all the time you break, you eat, you know. And my strategy prolonged war. Actually, Sun Tzu actually advised us never fight prolonged war. Because it costs too much, you wear out the team. However, in this case, it's a strategic prolonged war. Because I knew at the time, you see, the union uses HP as an example. Because HP do pay well, right? They want to ensure HP first so that they can get a high enough increased percentage and negotiate with other electronic companies. In fact, that's what my staff told me, and I believe that's true. So if that's the case, there's a timeline they must finish in order to negotiate with the other companies. And the timeline is shorter than my timeline to pay the bill. So I can hold out, it's okay, just be charged the bill which I recommend.
Right.
So for 3 months, we actually drag and drag until in the end, the unilaterally proposed number lower than what I'm supposed to pay. You know, it was actually, to be honest, it was a shock to me, right? Suddenly I said, I'm supposed to pay so much now, cannot pay so much. It's a happy problem, right? Being fair, I decided that we will offer to the union special bonus for those who perform well. Right? And the union was so happy, right? They knew that they were fair, right? And they let them tell them they are members, making them the hero. So they believe, the members of the union believe, that the chief negotiator for something that has been done. So they became the hero. To me, it's okay. Because to Sun Tzu, a good leader only concerned about achieving the goal of the organization, not self-glorification. That is Sun Tzu, very important vision of leadership. And I built my account because I did that, they trusted me. And we achieved yin yang harmony. And the union actually helped me. In fact, I told the senior management that helped me at the time. The union is my friend, it's our friend. We have 9,500 employees, my goodness. And we have so many new supervisors and managers who are still very wet behind the ears. They bully the employees, they do all sorts of things. We have problems on the ground. How do they all know what's happening? The union are our ears. You know, they tell us what is really happening. We work with them, we collaborate with them. In fact, sometimes the union come and tell me, I already counseled this member of mine who made this ridiculous complaint. Don't worry about it. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the power of the government. In my book, I was always in my book. Otherwise, you guys don't buy. Dialectical thinking and ambidextrous thinking. I know a lot of people hate this word, ambidextrous thinking. There are only two people that I heard actually openly say this word. I won't say who they are. But ambidextrous thinking is really the ability to deal with two ways, totally contradictory ways of thinking. You exploit what you have in the business, and then you still can explore new things, all at the same time. Right? If you want to learn more, remember. Analytical thinking is the foundation of this kind of approach, because you must recognize contradictions before you do anything. Right? And I explained my book using many, many examples so that it can help you to really understand what these two kinds of things are. Now I got 5 very important people in the community, business community, that wrote endorsement in my book. I'd like to share with you 2 more. Unfortunately, they can't be here, so they wrote me an email. And one of them is Robert Young, chairman of ICH Group, president of SNAP. He says this book is timely and will benefit many SMEs. They are growing to the region and in this uncertain time. And the other person who also wrote me an email also can't come because he's somewhere doing his business. Fu Pumping, I'm sure many of you know him, chairman of the Ministry, chairman of the Board of Trustees of SMU. It's a very timely book, he says, and will certainly help more people grasp the dialectical thinking in much of Chinese philosophy, exemplified by Sun Tzu. And hopefully, your readers, SMU people this season, many of whom I hope will be SMU students, will be able to exhibit the kind of ambidextrous thinking is no longer necessary in the world, no longer dominated by Western humanity. Thank you.